I'm Fatah, and I'm the interim vice president for campus life here at American University. And I'm also an adjunct faculty in the School of International Service as well. And my two colleagues who are here with me today are Tracy Calandrillo, who's the executive director for our counseling center here on campus, and they're on the second floor of this building. And then my other partner in crime is Andrea Brenner. Andrea wears a lot of hats, one of which having to do with really being the major person around the AUX curriculum. She's also a faculty member with the sociology department, and then as if she doesn't have enough to do, is also is the point person around University College until we have something that replaces University College, which will be sometime soon. So we've decided to do the presentation in sort of three buckets, as I call it. One, and I won't spend much time on it because we could spend hours on this, and we can have sidebar conversations for those who care to get more information. The first part is just to give you some data points. As you can imagine, like any institution, we collect a lot of data. And there's a lot of interesting information that we can derive from that data, but I just was intentionally selecting a couple of things because I think they're pertinent for the conversation here today, and I'll be very quick to do that. As if it's not enough, we have noise to distract us here. The second part is that we'll have Andrea, who then will really go into student development and student development theory, and then really in particular, what are the implications when you're working with first-year students and others. And Tracy will sort of wrap it up by talking about what do we need to take into consideration and the broader consideration for how we really can support our students in their learning. So that's sort of how we're going to go about this. With that said, I'm going to start very quickly, as I said again, with some of the data. And you have at your table, we have a couple of handouts because sometimes it's hard to see the data, especially the way it's presented here. And this is from our campus climate survey. Every other year, we survey our students to find out sort of the state of the campus climate. And we do that for both undergraduates and graduate students. And of course, the data set here has to do with undergraduate students. And I picked a couple of things, and I'm not going to go over this a lot, except to say that there are a couple of areas that I think we'll want to pay particular attention to. One is looking at it in terms of how often or rarely do you experience this. Number two, I'm learning how to view issues from different perspectives. This is going to become more and more important given the nature of our work and given what's going on nationally. And our students are telling us something about what opportunities they're afforded to really be able to look at issues from multiple perspectives. Then you will see also, it says my courses are intellectually challenging. You'll notice there that there's some data point there, and again, it has to do with students' perception of challenging or not, but again, it has implications for teaching and learning. And the part that I want to spend a little bit more time on is faculty and accessibility and the students' relationships to faculty. Faculty are accessible, you'll see the data for that one. Faculty clearly communicate their expectations of me, and that will become even more salient when we start talking about first-year students and why that matters. Faculty manage classrooms to ensure respectful treatment of all perspectives. I'm included in classroom discussions. And then how often or rarely would you say that my professors have made me excited about learning? You'll notice most of the time is at about 44%. Sometimes it's at 34. My professors have cared about me as a person. You'll notice most of the time 37, but then sometimes you have 31% there. Again, we'll give you the handout so you can really spend more time on it. But the reason why I'm providing particularly these data points, students' relationship to their faculty has such an impact in terms of some of the motivations. It has impact in terms of how they're going to access faculty, particularly outside of classes, especially if they're facing challenges. Then student personal care. Reach out to faculty for help when needed. You'll notice that sometimes it's at 33%, rarely it's at 14%. Then reach out to friends for help when needed. You'll notice that most of the time it's at 36%. Sometimes it's at 18%. Where do students go to get the resources that they need? Meet class course deadlines. Again, students, I think, are assessing themselves probably higher than they might be, and you may have some insights about that. Talk about some of biases and responses. Our students have learned, like everyone, there's some correct responses here that you want to be able to check off. So in this one, almost always 65%. I have questions about that. But then, you know, sometimes it's only 6%. Who knows, right? So I want to share this with you, but again, it's data to take back with you because it's going to inform the conversation about the so what. What is it? The so what question, right? Then I want to also, just as another data point, talk a little bit about socioeconomic and the socioeconomic status of our students. Because I think there's some perceptions around campus about the socioeconomic status of our students. And I want to talk to you about the students who are literally coming in this fall. And the profile of the students coming in this fall is consistent with the profile of students previously. There hasn't been much variation among the different cohorts. So what you will find out is that a significant number of our students do fill out the forms for financial aid, which is an indication of at least perceptions of need and real need in some cases. But what I think is striking and important here is the average family income of the incoming class. And that is at $167,000. Now, this data point is the average, right? So think about what's at this far end and what's at this other far end, right? Talk about socioeconomic challenges and tensions that can come as a result of that. And it has implications for the classroom. It does have implications for the classroom, and that's something that we want to take into account. The other thing is that 26% of those who filed for aid didn't need anything. They really were not in need because they could afford the cost of attendance at American University. And there you'll notice that that number is 26%. So picture this among our first year class. One in four has zero need. But you have 75% that have need that are all over the board. And what does the need look like? This is comparison of fall 2016. I want to go to fall 2017 for the sake of time. So you'll notice for fall 2017, 19% are Pella eligible. Those are the highest need students. The highest need students are about 19%. Then you'll see then after the Pell are the second level, which are the high needs, and there's 21%. That's important, that's significant. Because between high need and very high need, you'll see that there's a good number of our students who fall into that category. And then you have moderate is 17%, and then the no need also factor in our international students because really they can't file the federal aid forms because they're not US citizens and permanent resident. So there may be some international students who may be in need, but because they're not eligible for those funds, many of them will not file that. And so when you add that to this number, that's why you get the 36 or so percent that you have here. So it's to say that literally on our campus, and for Andrea and I who are sociologists, there's a class dimension that we have to keep in mind and that we have to sort of remember when we start thinking not only about American University, but our students and the assumptions that we may be making about our students. I'll stop there, and again, like I said, I'm happy to have sidebar conversations and follow up with you because we have a lot of data through our Office of Institutional Research, and I spend a lot of time taking a look at these because it has implications for all sorts of things, both in and outside of the classroom. And with that, I'm going to pass it on to Andrea.
Thank you so much, Fanta. And just to, I didn't want to interrupt you earlier, but I am not the faculty director of University College. I want to make that clear. I was the faculty director. I took one hat off. University College is well-staffed. Richard Duncan is the manager, and we do have a new faculty director, who's Cindy Bear Van Damme from the college writing program. So just wanted to take myself out of that and tell you it was all set. So I'm going to actually ask you to do a little exercise. I apologize because I know you're eating, but we are also going to eat and write. So if you can just grab a pen and any corner of a piece of paper, you're not going to be writing a lot. Share with your neighbor, please, if you happen to have a notebook. Thank you. So Fanta, Tracy, and I decided that really to talk to you about first-year students and undergraduate students in general, we wanted to take you back to your experience. So take a few notes right now. I want you to write down the year you left high school and or entered your freshman year of college. And if you had a non-traditional path and did not go right to college, whatever year, about 18, 19 years old. Then I want you to take some notes about where you were located before that transition and where you were going. Geography. Where you were currently living and where you were heading. Now try to take yourself back to that 18 or 19 year old self and some of those feelings that you had, emotions, nerves, also responsibilities. Who are you leaving? What were you leaving? Were you leaving a hole, a financial hole, a responsibility hole, an emotional hole? And then what feelings, emotions, anxieties were you looking towards in your new environment? If you did have a traditional experience being dropped at a college, think about that moment when you drove onto that campus, or however you got to that campus. Did you want to get out of the car? Did you run out of that car? Or did you have a totally different experience than the one I'm envisioning right now? Okay, now I want you to do something a little bit challenging and creative, but I'm only going to give you about 2 minutes. I want you to write a newspaper headline incorporating all of these notes. And the newspaper headline is about you and that transition. Take 1 more minute. Right, I would love to ask somebody to share.
So I have here, future president places himself in student debt.
Anyone else?
Privileged local youth eagerly going nowhere.
Farm kid from Northern Illinois dropped at AU.
Jewish girl goes to Catholic college and thrives.
Any others? Okay, the important point here is as we think back about our younger selves, and this is for people 40 and beyond, many of us actually picture a 24-year-old younger self. But when we're thinking about teaching first-year students, we're really talking about an 18 or 19-year-old early self, which is very, very different than a 24-year-old self. So I do want you to kind of keep in mind that is the mindset of our entering students. And we're going to talk to you a little bit about student development. Can you?
Yes.
Thank you. So very quickly, what is student development? Student development is an actual academic field. And it is a study of the way that students grow, progress, and increase their developmental capabilities as a result of an enrollment in higher education. And there are three different types of student development. Lots of our first year seminars, our first year experiences classes, like our AUX class that we've developed, are focused on all three of these. The idea of change, the idea of growth, and the idea of development. So kind of keep that in the back of your mind. And if you look at the notes you took on your own journey, do you see words of change, growth, and development in there? That's really forefront in some of our teaching, or should be in some of our teaching. So then we've got three major types of student development theory. I'm not going to go into them, but if anyone's interested, we're happy to send these to you electronically. And all of our first year classes really should be focusing on all three, because they're all important for the 18, 19 year old brain. The first one is the psychosocial approach to student development. And that's really where we look at the progression that students have in their own identity development. And that newspaper or newspaper headline that you wrote may very well be changed if I asked you to do it at the beginning of your junior year or at the beginning of your senior year. And that's supposed to happen. That's a normal process in development. We also have cognitive structural. And that really illuminates changes in the way people think and make decisions. So we cannot ask a first-year student to necessarily do the same assignment that a senior, we can ask of a senior. But instead of dumbing down our first-year assignments, student development theory thinks about it a little differently. They say, we're going to give a similar assignment, but we're just going to offer a lot more support to that first-year student. So it's not a simplistic assignment, it's a similar assignment, but instead of maybe assigning journal articles, we also need to teach them how to read a journal article. By their senior year, we make the assumption that if we give them a journal article to read, they will know how to read it. Okay, so it's just a different way of thinking, not necessarily a 100 level or a 500 level course. Is that dramatically different in content area? But it really differs in the level of support that we offer. And the third type of student development is the typology type. And the idea here, and many of you maybe have heard of Alexander Aston's work, this is that for learning to occur, students must be engaged in their environment. And our complex problems classes, our AUX classes, all geared towards first year learning, are really focused around understanding that the student must be engaged. That does not mean that teaching is performance art. That does not mean you need to be an entertainer. It means that you need to think about students constantly being engaged in their environment as they're learning. So I put together a list, I'm sorry the font is so small, of 10 ways that faculty can really promote an understanding of student development in the classroom. So I'm going to go through them quickly. Letting students know that they have the freedom to disclose their thoughts without fear of attack or rejection from the instructor or from classmates. That's really important, not just the instructor, but from classmates as well. And lots of ways to go about doing that. One of them is something that many of our first year classes do, which is a class contract that the group writes together. And these are rules for appropriate behavior in this class. Number two, recognize that students must begin at their own level, move at their own pace, and master each succeeding level of learning before really moving on. And again, that's the idea of 18, not 24 or 26 year old thinking. Number three, create ways for students to be able to observe and interact with others to expand both intellectual and social collaboration. And this is the difference between a week-long orientation program, which is absolutely needed, but also a freshman transitions course, like our AUX course. There's a lot of material that's thrown over a week of learning. We don't expect that cognitive change to take place over a week, where we can see over 15 weeks, it's a remarkable development that happens in that first year brain. In order to really make this happen, encouraging classrooms to work individually, in pairs, in groups, really letting students' brains mature in the way that they're thinking, but also meeting other people, because that social interaction, that will I have any friends here moments, is really quite important to a first year student. Number four, and I know many of us do this already, take a genuine interest in students' individual journeys so that an atmosphere of support and care can be established. Lots of classes are now starting to require one office hour visit because we realize that once we get the student over the threshold once, they'll come back. Typically, lots of AU students don't start coming in droves to office hours until the spring of their sophomore year. And that pattern has not yet been developed. So that's something that you might want to consider if you don't already do that in your classes. once insisting that they come in, and very naturally, many, not all, but many of the students continue to come. Also asking students for preferred pronouns, as I'm sure you know we do in many situations here, wonderful to do in a classroom. Provide classroom situations where non-traditional learning can take place. That does not have to be every class, but maybe every once in a while, sitting in tables, sitting in circles, sitting in a non-hierarchical format. I like to use with my, I love this expression with my sociology students about myself going to a doctor. I usually use a gynecologist because I like to be edgy. So I say to my students, think about the power play that that happens, right? I'm sitting in a paper robe on a table, and a doctor comes in fully clothed and is standing. Think about that power play right there. And how, not with the paper robe, but the idea of that power play is really perpetuated in the classroom, right? The students are sitting, they're taking notes, they're nodding, they're looking up at this person of power in the front of the room and that hierarchy that we drive. So every once in a while, maybe shake that up a little bit. Student becomes teacher becomes student, where we all learn from each other. Providing suggestions and non-threatening challenges that can be the impetus for the student to grow intellectually and socially. And that's also sending an email to your student. What's something I just did this past semester? I had a student who was a brand new student in my AUX class. She was very interested in writing her own music. And every time I saw an open mic night that came across, I don't go to open mic nights, but every time I saw something across my email, I would just forward it to her. And she actually got into some open mic nights and then started to do that regularly. And it's that's that little contact to say, you went out of your way to tell me this special thing about you, so I'm gonna now try to give you some avenues to pursue that, even if I know nothing about that field. When impasses and problems arise, demonstrate problem-solving strategies. And that is really where faculty need to learn the resources at AU. Now, if anyone wants to follow up, the AUX curriculum is a wonderful place to start because we force all of those resources on students, but we're happy to put any faculty member in our Blackboard course so they can learn. If a student comes, you don't have to solve all their problems, but the idea is to know where you can send them to term. And that's really, really very important. Regularly assessing students' academic and behavioral progress. We talk about explicit learning objectives in a class, telling students why you're teaching them what you're teaching them. And then also frequent and accurate feedback. Super important, especially for first year learning. That is the most important time when I hear that freshman student says, I didn't know how I was doing in a class until week 12 of week 14. That's something we may hear in law school, but for an 18-year-old brain, that's rough because they really have no idea how they're doing. Understanding the students need to fit in. And that's a big one. So instead of doing what I just did, asked you to do a little exercise and then share with a class, I would not do that if you weren't adults. I would maybe have an intermediate step where I'd say, now pair up with someone, share your stories, tweak it as you will, and then let's see, and you'll see how many more students will share, because they need to test those smaller dialogues and relationships. And then the last one, being proactive and transparent about the challenges of transition to college. And you can even share what you just did. I remember when, here's when, they're amazed. You were 18 once? That's remarkable, right? And the idea that transitions are challenging, college is supposed to be hard, and if you gotta be, it's okay. And being with them on that journey, that openness, that transparency is really terrific. So before I turn the microphone over to Tracy, I just want to take you through one last thing. And these are major differences between high school and college. Really common sense, but just something to think about. Where the student is coming in with, and again, everyone's got a different high school experience. This is a very traditional high school experience. But if a student is coming in from a traditional high school experience, the teacher-student contact is totally different, right? They can stop by at lunchtime, before school, after school. They have frequent contact with their teachers. And now all of a sudden, it's invitation only for the most part, right? Either need to make an appointment or drop by during office hours, which might be when I have a class, and I'm kind of scared to tell you that I can't come then. And maybe I don't know that there's another opportunity. So that's something to think about. Competition in grades. Good grades can be obtained with minimal effort in many high school classes. And then you get to college. Wow, maybe I was a B student all along, right? So that idea that minimal effort may really not produce A's. Counseling and dependence, of course, Tracy will talk to you more about this, but students relying on their support system for advice and decision-making constantly, right? Somebody is often there in the evenings. and that their family boundaries, restrictions are put upon them. That doesn't mean that those boundaries are not still there in college, but they're frequently through texting or through through phone calls. And students need to start relying on themselves and also do start relying on peers, and sometimes may not always be getting the best advice. So motivation, students get stimulation to achieve or participate from parents, teachers, and counselors, and now all of a sudden we drop them somewhere and expect them to know how to be motivated completely on their own. Freedom, not something you'll see in all of your offices, all of our classrooms. Students' freedom is limited often in high school. Their days are numbered. Their days are very highly timed. We know what time you're getting up. We know what time you're getting home. That changes dramatically when nobody is waking you in the morning and telling you have to be home by a certain time. That's when our students, I'm sure Tracy could speak to this, Thanksgiving is a phenomenal time to look at, because you see, you know, what do you mean, while I'm under your roof, I have this bedtime. Nobody's been checking on me for the last couple of months. Distractions, same kind of thing. There are distractions from school, but they're frequently controlled in high school, and then all of a sudden, we've got a lot of distractions here, and how do students deal with that? The last one, and probably the most important, is value judgments. Students often make judgments at home in high school based on family and cultural values, and of course those still exist, but now students are in classes and they are really open to new lenses of learning and can think outside of their comfort zone. Thank you.
Okay, so we're going to kind of take it back up to about a 30,000 foot view and come back down into a closer apply piece towards the end. But this buzzword that's out there for a lot of us, the word thrive. When we think about the college experience, thriving doesn't mean everything's going great at every moment and you're getting A's on everything and it's just all smooth sailing. Thriving is another word that's out there for a lot of us in the world right now is resilience. And so when we think about fostering a community that encourages students to thrive by developing their resilience, that's something that requires us to be able to really think about how do we set the conditions for that before the students arrive. And when we think about the work that we do, whether that work is in the classroom or in a therapy office like it is for my staff, or if it's in the advising office, or it could be on the playing field when they're doing an intramural sport. So I'm going to talk about how we get there and sort of what that might look like when you're in the classroom with students. So first, let's start from a public health perspective. This is actually, Jolynn and I did a presentation a few years ago where we really wanted to look at what's the effect of college on the person who's 18 to 22 years old. Well, we can think about it in the context of there are protective factors and there are risk factors for college. So we could say college is good for you. If you're 18 years old and you go to college, some things that happen for you in the context of your individual self, your familial experience, and the school or community experience, people who go to college are achieving something. You're pursuing a degree. That tends to be something that people are excited about and feel good about. There's a future orientation. You go to college for a reason, multiple reasons, but one of those reasons is to get a degree, so that degree has a purpose to it. That's thinking about your future, and we know that's a protective factor for how people are able to function when they have hope for the future. Family. Often, in good situations, there's a balance of autonomy and relatedness to family that can come out of being in college, which is different than if you stayed at home and you didn't transition into a college experience after you finished high school. And then the school and community, as we just heard, from high school to college, you experience a shift in your relationship with the people who are your instructors, the people who are adults in your life. You're 18, you often don't yet think of yourself as an adult. So those relationships change in a way that can be protective and helpful. There's also opportunities for exploration in work and school. You think about our students, they have so many opportunities to practice in laboratories like an internship, and how important that really is. So on the flip side, college is bad for you. Which, what I mean by that is, there are some things about college that actually are considered to be risk factors in terms of the conditions of the experience, and particularly for one's mental health. So we know that because of, we're going to talk a lot more about stress, but because of the conditions of stress, that can actually exacerbate and activate for someone who's already vulnerable to an onset of depression or anxiety. College can kind of trigger that because of the stress that students experience. There could also be a delay to committing to those adult roles, whether that's, okay, I'm going to manage my own finances, or I need to wear clothes that aren't pajamas to go to a job. Sometimes that can get delayed, and that doesn't necessarily in and of itself cause a risk factor, but it may make it harder for somebody to do that transition into a more traditional working environment if they don't experience that earlier. Family. Well, there's a risk factor just in leaving home. I think all of us have probably sat with someone who's really struggling with making that adjustment away from those people that we talked about a minute ago who are helping you really structure your day or your time, or being that resource that you know and trust who really does believe that you can do it. You don't have that when you go to college. You have to create it, okay? The other thing that can happen for many of our students, if they experienced family dysfunction before they left home, they continue to experience that family dysfunction. It's just sometimes exacerbated by the student not being present for that. Either because for some students, they can feel guilty about that and it's difficult for them, or the events that are happening at home impact their ability to perform while they're in school. And then lastly, some risk factors around community or school. It can give you less of a support to go into the world, particularly for our students who come here and don't already come with a support system. Maybe they aren't with their friend group. They haven't made friends since they were 5 years old when they started in kindergarten. And that can be a really difficult time because there's a risk factor there of not having people who know you. And then the other piece to that is social adversity. And that social adversity can take a lot of forms. That might be the events of the world around our students and how that impacts how they relate to each other. That might be for somebody exploring their identities. There's freedom and positivity that comes with that, but there is also the potential for a lot of distress. So we kind of create this environment for that to happen. And for our students, as much as there might be part of them that wants that to happen, it can also be very, very distressing, especially if they experience a traumatic event as part of that exploration. Okay, so just setting some stage. Actually, the word millennial is not working so much for our college students anymore. We're moving into a new generation, so bear with me that I'm doing some research that pretty soon is going to be less relevant. But millennials are a generation that says that stress impacts them very greatly, both in the classroom and outside of the classroom. And so individuals who bring that experience into the college environment, we have to be really ready to consider the real conditions of stress and how that impacts what they do while they're here. They're also more likely than other generations to say that they experience loneliness and isolation. And so when it comes to all of these data, you can see the trend at the counseling center and how we're seeing students more and more reach out to counseling resources. Okay. So going on to our next slide. So you've heard, some of you have heard me talk about this before. Distress can be like an experience of being trapped in a car. Once that car gets hot, if you couldn't get out of it, you're going to start to feel uncomfortable and distressed. We think about that as a trap, okay? We want to reduce the trap and get that person out of that experience of feeling stuck. So with you all, and with all of us at the university, we want to keep the student at the point where they can get out of that experience of stress, because if you got trapped in the car, you're going to start to feel distressed. If an individual is experiencing too much anxiety or stress, that's going to move into distress, and the most extreme versions of that, someone is likely to create something that's unhealthy, like self-harm. Okay? Okay, so what we want to do when we think about how we move towards thriving is have resources to support students to get them out of that car. And I see a lot of familiar faces in the room. Is there anybody who would say that they really don't know what the resources in the Office of Campus Life are? Okay, so because of time, I want to move to some things. You'll see the next slide here is reviewing the resources in Campus Life. We can do that together, or I can answer questions individually, but I want to spend a little bit more time on these last slides talking about how wellness is really a community effort. And so when we think of thriving, I want to go back to some of what might have come to mind for you when you were doing the exercise that Andrea talked about what you were like when you were 18 and what you thought about. There are really places in the classroom experience where students can get stuck, or in the choosing the classroom experience piece, because our first year students, they are really kind of coming to the university not knowing how they're going to do in the classroom or what classes are working for them. So we think of those as traps, and we want to think about what are the levers to get that car door open, and then what are things to consider. So you can, this is also on the handout that's there on the table for you. You can think about, for example, the person might not really know that the classes that they're taking doesn't necessarily fit with what they thought it was going to be. That happens all the time. We want to try to be thoughtful about how to support students when they still need to take some classes, but the content isn't working for them anymore. So they can think about what did we want that to be like, or how might you take what you're learning from what you don't know and to apply that to figuring out what you do know, because we all know that that's just as important, being able to rule out what we don't want. Second piece to this is time management traps. Your students all are struggling with time management. That goes to that piece of high school is structured, college is not. What can you do in the classroom? You don't need to be talking about time management per se, but you might find ways that you can help a student pay attention to how you would want them to manage their time around a project. That goes to that piece also that Andrea was mentioning about not giving them information about their performance until the end of the semester. It helps for students to manage their time if they know, I have something that's coming up that's really going to take several days of hard work, so I can fit that in with all of the other classes that I'm taking at the same time. Go to the next section of traps. Communication traps. This is probably the one we see play out in the classroom that students are probably the least willing to talk to you about, and that is communication. Going to office hours, being able to tell you, I got stuck here and I don't really know how to figure out the answer to the questions that you're asking. Students tend to see their classmates as a marker of what they're supposed to be doing. So if it seems like no one else is asking a question, well, I shouldn't have a question either, right? Well, that's a communication trap, because I know for myself, if I don't ask a question, I'm not going to get the answer. I'm pretty sure I'm probably going to mess that up in the future. So getting past that barrier of being afraid to ask is really, really important. So when you can create times in your class for, you know, often students want to know about this piece of the assignment. That gives them a chance to ask that question without feeling like they're in showing weakness. Okay, and then the last section, self-care traps. So this is where your empathy about what it's like to be a first-year college student can come back into play. Even if there may be times when you can kind of weave in there, like, I know when I was getting close to Thanksgiving, this was the first time I went home, and these are the things that came up for me, or, wow, I always got a cold right before finals because I wasn't sleeping. If there's a way to weave that in, it can be really helpful. That's something that your partners outside the classroom are also doing, is really helping students think about, what do you do to take care of yourself? The way we think about it in the counseling center is there really isn't a big connection between the mind and the body in that sense. We need to take care of both, and they have an interrelationship with each other. So if you don't want students to get stuck with, they're not able to go to class and do what they need to do because they're not sleeping. Okay. And then self-reflection traps. So again, students compare themselves to each other. That idea that comparing your insides to someone else's outsides is damaging. We inherently don't know how other people are doing, but it's very common for students to say, I'm the only one who's struggling. Everyone else seems to have it figured out. Oh my gosh, I sit in a classroom where people talk to me about all the traveling they've done and I've never gone anywhere. Well, that's all social comparison, and it generally doesn't lead to them feeling better about themselves. So ways that you can, again, use that empathy that you have to help students break that down or just be open about where you were when you were that age can be really helpful and beneficial in taking away some of that social comparison. So last slide I want to show here is this is really kind of the idea of how we all really work together as a team, and resilience and thriving comes from attending to and integrating students' abilities to connect with themselves, their abilities to connect with other people, to build a resilient culture, which is our shared responsibility, and then to navigate events. So the last kind of piece there is bringing into how we all work together to respond to things or take care of each other when we're in situations that are stressful. We can do that in the classroom with them, even if we're not focusing on a world event and how it affects us. We can still be aware of it. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Christy. We're interested in your perspective, your questions, your reflections. Yes. And we need a mic, please. Sorry. We need a microphone.
My question is having to do with the problem of time management and the problem of anxiety. So I create more deadlines and break down the assignments into smaller pieces so that they can successfully complete the assignment. And then they tell me that creates more anxiety because they have more deadlines.
Well, the first thing that comes to mind for me is that I think it really is challenging when you have a lot of different kinds of learners in your class and you're trying to navigate what might be a helpful solution for one person's way of thinking or managing their experience causes another person to be stressed out. I think naming that is really helpful too. I talk to students a lot about the analogy of video games. Since so many of them have played a video game, there's a lot of different kinds of video games. There's some you might be really good at, and it might be that you're really good at thinking on your feet and figuring out how to save part of your energy so that you can use it at the end. Other people, that might not be what you're good at. The whole point for them is that they need to take the experience of what they learn in your class and apply it to the next one. So it's probably like hard to sit with them getting stressed about it, but help them understand that stress is them learning. And then give them multiple options. So for some people it might be, know that this is the ultimate deadline. If it works better for you to work back from there and set your own multiple deadlines, that's great. But the reason you do it is so that you give them something to scaffold onto. Does that help? I think some of them are just gonna be anxious no matter what because, right. That performance expectation is so high for our students. They have that, but they don't have the experience yet. So that in and of itself is stressful. If I don't know, I know I'm supposed to do something really well, and I haven't never done it before, I'm going to be stressed about that. So there's a little bit of like just helping them tolerate that.
Thank you so much for all your work. Is it on?
Is it on?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm struck still that so few of our students think we care about them.
And
we really need to go more in depth on strategies to demonstrate that for them. So I'd like to start a conversation around that. That's like paramount to everything else. And I don't know how much more, as a Jewish mother, I can demonstrate how much I love them. I feed them. I invite them to my house. I won't go into all the details, but so I'm like wounded by that statistic. But the other thing is, when I have entered into a relationship with a student who's troubled, it's that fine line of when do you then report it to the care network? Because I don't want it to just be this. Not mechanical, that's the lack of word, but just reporting them to the authorities kind of thing. I know that it's not like that, but if you could just talk about that a little bit. I don't know what happens on their end after I have reported a student who's in distress.
Sure, so I'm sorry, I'm gonna be speaking for the Dean of Students Office a little bit when I give you my answer. Hopefully you would take away the construct of both and. So it isn't a matter of, I'm going to hand this over and I am done, but I'm going to continue to stay responsive from my end, and I'd like to see the student get additional support. The purpose of what happens in the care network isn't, oh, I've handed that off, it's all over, and I know that's not what you're saying, but the idea is more eyes need to be on this person in the situation, particularly in the case where there's multiple events happening for that person across campus. So that would be one thing. The other thing I would say is it also is very important that you consult with myself, with the Dean of Students, and especially if you're wondering what's happened to the student. Now, you know that they might not be able to give you all the concrete answers back, but certainly you can hear from them something along the lines of, here's what we generally do in these situations. Or you could ask a question of, how can I reinforce the care in the classroom given that this person has come to my office hours and told me that they're really trying. So I'm giving you a general answer to things that often have context really in cases that's different in each case, but that the purpose of the care network is to bring them into the situation with you. So there's a both and. You as the person in the classroom and the Dean of Students office as the kind of conduit to the rest of the support system.
And I think one of the other ways to think about that, as Tracy has talked about it, is really thinking of it within the framework of a community of care, right? And within the framework of a community of care, what I would actually say to the faculty who are here, when you have submitted a report to the care network, that is not a handoff. We don't want that to be a handoff. What we would like to see it is as a partnership. And because you have relationships with that student, and in doing that, in getting them to the care network, it might be that the person then who's responding may not have yet had a relationship with the student.
Right.
You have that context of trust. You have a lot, and also you've seen that student behavior in the classroom. And the students spend a lot of time in your classrooms, especially when they've built trust with you and in your office hours. But the more we can connect the dots, the more then we're able to see what might be this line between stress and distress that Tracy has talked about, so that we can be much more proactive before that student really falls completely through the cracks. So that's one of the things that we're gonna be spending a lot more time on, is how do we in many ways shift the paradigm of what the care network is, so that it's not seen as that handoff. I've sent it, and now, you know, I'm expected to dissociate from it, when in fact we actually need that partnership.
Can I just add one more thing that has to do with language? If we do talk to that student, often it's just the simple words, because remember, the student is often thinking, I am the only one that has any issues, let alone just this issue. The, oh, this is such a common problem. Or, I've been talking recently to other students who have similar situations. Sometimes that is the one little bumper that we need to keep that conversation going.
I would say, I've been in your shoes.
That's great. That's really helpful. If you can speak to that and you feel comfortable to say something, it doesn't have to go into details, but to say, I've been in your shoes, or it is so stressful when X happens. Let me get you to the resources so that you can get some support. Yeah.
Yes.
Scaffolding on this discussion of the care network, I'll say that often in my experience, when I have made it to submitting a care network, I'm now in distress.
Yes.
And so one thing that I think that, right, I mean, typically this has become a really weird thing, and I don't know what's happening, and it's been disruptive in office hours or class, and emotionally disruptive. So I think part of the care network that I know sometimes can happen is I am still very engaged, but I don't know, and I know there's confidentiality, I don't know what's going on there, but it would be nice sometimes when you get a care network to know just some shot back, like, received, something is happening, right?
You should get an email response back that
submitted
it.
Okay, I think,
yeah.
I've had some bad times in the past, but that's good,
I think it's an automatic process once it's been
received. Oh, I mean, I'll get something saying, yes, this has been in the system, but that's an automatic, that's not from a human. I want community with the care network, right? I
that's
want a
part
person
of what's, yeah.
to tell me, I hear that you're in distress, what's going
right.
on?
I would recommend a call, and you
that's
can consult
right.
with us as well, because that's, sometimes it's that stress of, oh my gosh, what's happening? Is my person going to be okay? Or I am really freaked out by this because it was really distressing for me. I'm bothered by it. Absolutely. And the person who's working with the student can't tell you the answer to that. It doesn't take away your distress about it, though. And that's where that additional consultation, especially if you really do feel bothered, can be helpful. Yeah, you have a very hard job, and you don't have a whole lot of tools of managing that. Except to try to get the student support, I think that consultation, the care network doesn't replace that. Right?
And I really appreciate the comment that you're making about this, because one of the things is that, you know, you come up with a process and you need to constantly keep reevaluating it, right? Mm-hmm. And I think we're exactly at that place when it comes to what's in the toolbox for all of us. And I think this is one of those times where we're certainly at a place where we need to do a reset. So one of the things that I can commit to and that you will see coming up in the fall is that there will be a lot more time spent with faculty around what does that community of care look like, and how is it that that engagement that you've just talked about becomes an important engagement, because actually it sets up the students for better success.
So I have a couple of follow-up questions, and one of them has to do, you showed all the statistics of the incoming class, class-related, but I was wondering if you have that disaggregated as well by race and ethnicity, and how much overlap is there? Because I think that also relates to the care community in terms that many students and faculty members explained that have expressed that a lot of these resources are not culturally and appropriate often. So that's part of it. And the other part is, and this is something that came up in the faculty retreat as well, that there is all this talk about the students' needs and how we need to care for the students and embrace the students as people, not only as students. But there seems to be, what you were saying, you know, not enough resources for faculty to do that, and especially not built in incentives for faculty to do so, because we are constantly being faced with the challenge of spending more and more time on students while also facing more and more pressure, academic pressures, and being evaluated on how well we perform those tasks as academics, right? So you kind of have the usual suspects of professors, basically in much larger numbers, faculty of color and female professors, doing a lot of these, I mean, you have three women out there, doing a lot of this care work that other faculty members are investing their time in more aggressive academic endeavors, and those are highly and more objectively rewarded when we're evaluated. So I was also wondering if there is some kind of work, if this is actually an issue and we are becoming a care community, which I think it's wonderful, if there are also there's also a conversation in the university to actually value that work that we put on as professors, because I spend countless hours in my office with students, and I know a lot of my usually male colleagues, I know they're wonderful male professors who spend a lot of time with their students, and I really value that. But it tends to be, if you look at demographics, it tends to be certain faculty that invest more time, and that is not recognized or rewarded by the institution. So there's a little bit of mixed messaging there, as well as getting resources to do it, because I wasn't trained to do that. So I value that.
So I'm going to, two quick things. One is that the data that I did show, the only one that's actually for incoming students is the one on the financial aid. The other set of data is for all of the graduate students. Mm-hmm. And with that said, we have that data by race, ethnicity. We have it also by school. And one of the things that we're really doing is we're pushing the deans to have the conversation and share that data by school as well, so that you can see what does it look like broadly and within our own respective communities, right? Because I think that's important for the work that we're doing. So that's the first thing. The second thing, going back to your question, which is a really key one, about faculty and what is rewarded and how do we signal the rewards structures and system and what is being asked, is an ongoing conversation, and I will say an active conversation. It hasn't exactly landed fully where I think some of us would like to see it landed, but I do think what it has raised and has brought up is, with the changes for our students, and given the institution that we aspire to be, there are, on good days, productive tensions. Mm-hmm. On challenging days, very, very critical tensions that arise, right? Between the scholarship piece and the teaching piece. And so that is something that really does need to be reconciled on so many levels, but the conversations are happening with the deans, it's happening on the provost level, and then the conversations are really going to also be happening with the department heads and so forth, to gather a little bit more information about what does that landscape looks like, I think is one of those things, because it's a really important point. The piece about the toolbox is another piece that we need to look at, because in looking at the toolbox, part of it is assessing where is the most critical need and where can you have the highest impact. And then the same way we said students are, you know, stretched with time, so are the faculty. So we also have to be creative about how best to get that delivered in a way that is really utilizing faculty time in the most productive way. So that's, I think, an ongoing work that needs to happen But we do recognize that there's absolutely a need for more in the toolbox. You know, some of the work that Andrea and others presented today looked at first year students. But I can tell you that for our returning students, with what's happening nationally, they're gonna be coming back with the highest level of stress before we even hit, you know, week two. And how we're able to kind of unbundle that and the work that's gonna need to happen, we'll find that some of the resources that were provided by first year students are gonna apply again. Because some of our students will have had some setbacks before they get here, and we're gonna have to really pick up from there and do that work. But I think your point about how service happens, who's doing the sort of the care that we've talked about, and what are those tensions, I think are very real, and I've certainly have heard it from faculty on a lot of levels, yeah.
Can I just, thank you for your comments, I think they're really powerful. One, I would also interject that term faculty are also in that group with women and faculty of color. I would also say that there needs to be a wider discussion on this campus about teaching, and that teaching doesn't only happen in a classroom, that staff are teaching in their offices, that we are teaching in office hours as faculty. We need a wider definition, in my opinion, of teaching. The third is being very creative with your FARS report, because there are places where you can advocate for the mentoring and the teaching you do outside of the classroom. And I just think it's figuring out how to actually report that is a piece of that as well.
Yes, please, the microphone, thank you.
I'm gonna change the subject a little bit. So great expectations of students and then what they actually receive can cause a lot of stress.
Yes.
And, you know, it's been my experience that, you know, I get the feeling in early office hours when I talk to students that they have the expectation of doing really well, and certainly we all want them to do very well. They think anything less than a B, certainly they think they would get an A, but A and a B, and, you know, if that doesn't pan out in the course of the course, then it causes them a lot of stress. And are there strategies up front to kind of deal with great expectations of students?
And maybe are people in academic school next?
At first I thought you said great expectations. That's a different conversation, right? I mean, well, what got them into college? It was good grades as part of that, right? Like, so we conditioned high school students how important their grades are, and then they have to shift to a wholly different playing field when they come here. I think it's part of that, again, that empathy for that's hard. And your point is a really good one, that you're kind of left with this dilemma of, do I go with the great expectations piece so that the students kind of get what they were expecting to get, or do I try to find some way to hold them to a different process of what the grade means in the evaluation of the performance and learning that they've done in your course, which is really different than high school. And I think that expectations piece is your answer, because there's always going to be a difference in their expectation and then what they're challenged with, because they haven't been in college before. So they don't know yet. And that is hard, and especially since that's different than what they've been conditioned to think about it.
I would say, especially with first year students, rubrics. Because if you say an A is this, and these are the reasons I gave it to you, or the B plus is this, and here are the reasons why, not only can you actually work through a rubric form with a student, and ideally it's in your syllabus so they know about it, but it's a way for them before they hand in an assignment to actually check your grading rubric and see if I did this well, I will receive this. It's also a point of argument, right? Because they really do need that ability to come to office hours and come to you and say, can you talk me through why I didn't get a better grade? And if you've got the rubric, you can actually talk them through. Ideally then, the next assignment, right, you want to see them make those changes, right? And that's the most frustrating to me as a faculty member, is when the student makes the same mistakes that I've taken time to write comments or on the rubric, whatever, and I think, man, why didn't they go and actually read my comments? So to me, rubrics is the answer for quite a bit with grade discussions.
The other thing I would add to that is that for students, one of the things that I will do around the rubric piece is I will say to them, when I assign a grade, I've spent a lot of time really putting the effort in it, and I'm quite mindful of how critical grades are. But if, so if you're going to come and challenge me, you're going to come and challenge me on the learning that needs to happen, and we won't spend time initially on the grade. So come with the questions that you have, which again, I think demonstrates whether they've read the comments, whether they've done those different pieces. And I think part of that goes back to Andrea about how we in some ways have to retrain our students, and we have to help them to be able to ask the questions, but they shouldn't be afraid to ask those questions.
So along with the grade expectations conversation, I work with a lot of students who are in denial of their actual academic condition, and we dismiss students, and I support faculty who are first responders, and I also have those conversations with students who, for whom the reality is then suddenly upon them. In spite of multiple probation interventions, early warning notifications, care network, all of it very well documented, then these students are faced with the reality of disclosing this failure to their families. And my students in particular are international students who have a lot of challenging layers for those cultural dimensions in those discussions. There are linguistic barriers, so oftentimes when I'm conversing with faculty, we have, with parents, we have translators. It's a very complicated situation to also deal with a student who's crying in your office about being dismissed and all of the terrible life that they're envisioning for themselves. So I wonder if you have any guidance for faculty directly, but also for those who work with and supervise faculty who are often the first responders in those very difficult conversations, and then for the conversation with parents as well. Sorry if that's a lot, Dan.
That's
good. So, right, that is hard. Well, a couple things. One is, first, for yourself, sort of having some compassion that it is hard. And that I think it's really important to start there, because that allows you to have a little space. I'm being a little bit squishy here, but a little space of empathy for the person's distress, right? You gotta be careful that you don't put yourself in a bind of, I gotta get this right so that they aren't sad anymore or they aren't scared anymore, because when you're getting dismissed from school, a place where you wanted to be, that is stressful, okay? It also isn't a, oh gosh, is there a way that we can change the answer? That's also kind of a piece that's probably not going to happen unless there's another process that involves an appeal. So it's, I think, really important to come into the conversation with some clarity about how you're going to describe the expectations, some clarity to understand what's possible. It might be when you're having that conversation with the family, using rubrics are so helpful, because the same idea of how did we get here? Well, we got here through this series of behaviors. Anchor it on the behavior, not on any kind of judgment about the students or their intention, because it really is, grades are earned and they're based on behaviors. And so that might allow you to be supportive of the people while also the content kind of walking through things that are a little bit more objective. Does that help? Yes. But, and then also make sure that you get support for yourself. Even if it's helpful before you start that conversation to say, this is something I do when I know I'm going to have a stressful conversation with someone, to say to one of my colleagues, this is really going to be stressful for me. We talk for a few minutes. That helps me feel like, okay, I can be a person and still do this, because otherwise I might not be able to take care of my own anxiety, and then I'm behaving in such a way with the family or the student that isn't as kind as I would like to be in that moment. I think that kind of support is really important, to have that empathy from somebody else who knows, yeah, it is really hard. And you're talking to somebody who's, that's their only child, and they have expectations that this person is going to, you know, make their dreams come true, and they may, but it's not going to be at the school. Very difficult.
I am mindful of we're out of time, but again, I think the most, I hope you leave with two things. One is that please reach out to each other, because there's lots of resources in this room beyond what's at this table. And so I think that's an important piece to know, that you're not alone, and to reach out. The second thing is, as well, as we said, you know, we have a lot more data. So we didn't want to overwhelm you, but there's a lot more resource information. So I encourage you to reach out to any of us with additional questions. And even frankly, what often happens is to say this, you know what, could we grab coffee? Could we grab a cup of coffee? Because I have some things that I've been kind of thinking about, and I just would like to bounce some ideas off someone and fill in the blank. That's certainly something that I would also encourage you to do. And then lastly, you know, thank you once again to the Center for Teaching, Research, and Learning for all the great work that they do. It really takes a village to plan these events and programs, and I just wanted to say a big thanks to the staff that's here and that's made this happen. Thank you.